Why I'm starting off this, but it's because I have a personal interest in this topic, and I've already drawn out floor plans for a house that I plan to build in North Carolina. Assuming I ever retire at this point, I'm not sure that's going to happen right away, but anyway. Matter of fact, my original interest was in log homes, and after going to a couple of shows and whatnot, I became more interested in the timber framing concept. And timber framing is actually quite old. Originated back in the Middle Ages, I believe. Many eons ago, they used to use mainly stone for building and a little bit of wood. But then wood became more common, and this kind of construction was originally used in building mainly barns and industrial structures of that of various natures. But then it became used in homes quite often, and some of these structures are hundreds of years old, even though they're made out of wood, and often they're only held together with wooden pegs. No glue, no nails, no screws. Just wooden pegs and mortise and tenon joints. And our guest today will talk about the construction technique, but I'm just going to start off with a brief PowerPoint showing you some potential structures that could be, and these are all modern. This is just a sketch of a typical structure. Each bay is surrounded by what's called bents. Bent is just a piece of framework like you see on the upper right there, made out of wood. And this particular structure has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bents in it. Typically those bents are spaced 8 to 12 feet apart, occasionally further. And that entire structure then is covered with a roof trusses that are also wood, and then some sort of sheathing. Of course, in the old days, the sheathing was actual boards, rough cut boards, and they were typically put on the outside to cover the interior. So all of that stuff that you see there wound up on the interior. Okay, next slide. Now that's a much more simplified one there. There's three bents there. Three roof trusses, and you can see how the thing is built, because the strongest shape that are in existence, and all engineers know this, is a triangle. So you build structures with triangles that are very, very stiff. So if you look at those roof trusses, they're all triangles, and even the bents have triangular braces on them, and that's to prevent the whole structure from racking. And in some cases, when they put the siding on the outside, it's put on diagonally, and those are shear walls, and the shear wall also helps to keep the structure from racking in the wind and that kind of thing. Next one. Just a different example, a little wider span there, and a little different structure for the roof, but that's not all that uncommon. It's more of a curved shape, and you get this big wide open clear space in between. Next one. That one's a little more busy, just a little different construction also. Some of the basics are the same. Here, if you look closely, almost everything's a triangle except right there in the middle where you got a rectangular opening upstairs. Next one.
For a chimney, is it?
I don't know. Possibly. You can do stuff like this. There's the main section, which is made of bents, and it has a curvilinear roof structure on it, but then there's a shed structure on the side. And that's one of the ways of getting additional space. And the next one is even a further extension of that, because you got the center bay, and that's typically your great room and kitchen and dining areas in there. And then there's two shed structures on either side, but in this particular case, instead of it being open all the way to the roof, there's going to be a second floor up there. And these were all downloaded off the internet, by the way, from various manufacturers. I believe that one was from a manufacturer in Texas. I think it was Texas Timber Framing or something like that. Next one. just some details about how these things are put together. This is a typical structure. You're seeing the pieces cut off, and Mike will talk about this, but there's an upright there with a mortise cut in the side, and if you look real closely, there's a little ledge sticking out at an angle there so that brace goes in there. Not only does the tendon fit in a mortise, but it sits down on that ledge that adds a little strength. Then there's a mortise on the upright which goes into the top beam, and that brace also goes into a mortise on the top beam. That top beam is typically going to span the length of the building, so it's typically a very long piece of wood.
What's the purpose of that angle on that tenon on the vertical piece?
Probably just to make it fit in there easy. I don't know.
Okay.
I'm not sure if the mortise is angled in a similar fashion.
So it's not dovetail, is it?
No, but it could be. Some of these beams are dovetailed. Typically, those dovetails are cut by hand, by the way. That's more common with the flooring joist to be dovetailed. Next one. And you see some fancier braces. They're still angular braces, but these are cut in a curved fashion, which makes it a little more attractive. Next one. That's a typical roof truss. And again, you can see the mortise and tendons joining pieces together. Next one. That's just another framing detail here where pieces are coming together in a corner. And how there, you don't see the mortise and tendons there, but all those pieces are joined with mortise and tendons. Next one. I just pulled this out of a magazine. This was a old barn, and I don't recall how old it was, but if you look closely, it's the same kind of construction. And if you look up there at the roof, it's covered with wooden boards, and that's common of the old structures. In fact, some of people have taken some of these old structures, barns and whatnot, and converted them to houses. Next one. Just another example of a joint where the bent joins the roof, and the roof has wooden planks on it, and you see the back has vertical wooden planks on it. Well, quite often those planks on the sides will be diagonal. Next one.
Hey, Gerry, can you clarify what you're calling a bent again?
A bent is just a single frame structure, and typically consists of two uprights at least and a piece that goes across. Okay, so these are large timbers typically, and typically they're attached to a foundation of some sort. It could be wood, or it could be concrete or stone or something of that nature, and these would be a typical upright that you're seeing down here, whereas this piece up here spans that. Now, it could be, that's the simplest form, and you're going to put your diagonal braces in here for racking purposes to keep this thing from easily moving back and forth like that. Now, that's the simplest bent you can get. You can get a lot more complex bents than this. But each one of these forms a bay, two of these forms a bay. That bay is tipped, this lid, this width can be virtually any size as long as, but you have to size these timbers accordingly. All right, but a typical, it might be 10 or 12 feet across here. It could be more, it could be less. Naturally, the beams become heavier the wider the span is. And then you would typically, that's just a bent, and you've got three or four of these going down the length of the building as a minimum. We call them frames, you know, but they call them bents. This is just a typical roof structure. Here you see the basic triangles, except right in the middle you've got rectangles, and that's probably because there's going to be rooms in there, you know. But if you see on either side, you get your triangles. Okay, next one. Now that's a much fancier. That's a one bent. It includes the uprights, the roof structure, and the diagonal braces, but you've got some curved pieces in there, so you can get some pretty fancy ones. So each one of those is I don't know that I can draw that, but they've just gotten a lot fancier than your standard rectangular. I've got something like this, and I'm not even going to try to copy it. But they start off with, nothing says that this top piece has to be straight. In fact, I'm not even going to try to draw that. You could have a curved arch across the top here, and then you could put your roof up above that, and so forth. Now, they've made that one more open, and we'll talk about this later, but that's basically a hammer frame, and the hammer frame is more open, and it's gives you a lot more vertical space. Next slide. There's a hammer frame also, and this you can see how that is constructed of basically triangular braces. Next one. That's just a porch, and so they've taken the basic concept of the timber framing and extended it onto the porch. So you can just take this for your projections from the house and use the same thing because it gives you that nice look. Next one. Now, just to give you an idea of why you might be interested in doing this kind of construction is you get some gorgeous stuff out of this. That's a typical interior. There's a walkway above there. It probably has bedrooms off of that walkway, whereas you get this big open space below it, and that's a hammer frame also, because you can see the pieces coming out and going straight up. You might not think that's strong, but if you look closely, that's a triangle. Okay, next one. There's another interior. This is quite common to put big stone fireplaces in it. And again, that has the walkway. That's probably looking the other way in that building. But anyway, next one. And you can get as fancy as you want. There's a little balcony up there, you know. Looks like it's got some curved pieces to it, but this is common. The common living area usually is very open like that. Now, if you look up there, the roof here is more standard trusses with a straight piece across and triangles above that. Next one. Again, the only difference here, there's the basic roof truss. The only difference here is they put the fireplace in the middle, but you see the big open space that you get out of here. And by the way, this is excellent construction for a shop. Why? Because you get that big, wide, open space. All right, now I think that was it, yeah. Now what I'm going to do here is pass around some stuff. I do subscribe to this magazine. It's called Timber Home Living, and this particular one has a couple of really four smaller homes. The home I'm designing is probably going to be 2,000 square feet or a little less, you know. So it's got some ideas for small homes. So if you can pass that around. And before I introduce our guests, I took a class from him at Highland Hardware. And he's basically in this business of building timber frames. And as you can see, a lot of stuff he brought in is reclaimed timber. That's common. People tear down some of these old structures and reuse those timbers in new ones, construction. But also sometimes a lot of very common today is these things are cut out of green wood, and this is all put together green, and of course you get some checking and that kind of stuff due to shrinkage. But also he had recommended, Mike had recommended a couple of books, actually several of them, but I did pick up a couple here that he had recommended. And I'll pass these around too. And there you can see a basic structure with no siding on it. Okay. By the way, the raising these things is quite an effort. As you can imagine, it took two of us just to lift that, and that's a dried beam. If that was green oak, yeah. And then you got a bent made out of these members, and you got to raise it up into place. Quite often done with cranes today, but it was done by hand in the old days. And this is the other book. It's not. It's more of a classic book, and it's all black and white. But it talks about all of these concepts and the different kinds of bents. And it's got some very interesting structures in it. I don't know if you can see that, but that's a barrel vaulted roof there. And this is common in some of these old structures, especially in Europe. I also have a handout for you. It comes from Fine Home Building. And this was a school in New England somewhere where you can actually go and take a class and they actually build a structure. This is an article out of an issue of Fine Home Building that they built a 12 by 16 structure during a week at this school. And I'm going to take such a class at John C. Campbell in May, the third week of May. Pass that around. Typically, all this work is done with hammers and drills and big chisels. That's a firmer chisel. It's 1.5 inches. It hadn't been honed yet, so it's not that sharp. Okay, as a matter of fact, I just bought it yesterday for my class. Mallet and typically drills, but I'll let our guest Mike Goldberg talk about this. Just a little bit of background on Mike. He does teach this class at Highland periodically. Of course, in a three-hour class or even here, you don't have time to build anything. But he has his own company called Wild Goose Projects, and he's actually in this business. So with that, I'll have Mike come in. Mike Goldberg.
And I'm 30 years old, and I'm a timber frame.
Turn on your microphone.
Now, really,
I do this right off the bat to show you guys material handling is like 95% of this work, and it'll kill you. These timbers are heavy, like Gerry was saying. It takes two. With this guy, I can move 1,000 pounds on these wheels easy. It's about a $400 cart, worth every penny of it. My back knows it too. What I'm going to do is I've got some other pictures. This is 30 years of timber frame, and y'all are welcome to peruse these if you want. And I'll just pass some on around. Different projects, and I wanted to write a couple of things up here before we get going too much. John, what was that website with the recycled wood?
It's jointery, E-U-T-R.
E-U-T-R-E-E.com. Okay, and I'm gonna give you a couple more here. I'm gonna leave them up here for y'all. This TF Guild is the Timber Framers Guild. It's now an international guild. I played around with them for about 20 years. Some of these pictures in these books are projects that we did around the world. So if you don't get enough information here today and you want to take another course, go to tfguild.org and the members have all kind of courses. They have all kind of extended. What a lot of them will do is actually have a project, and you'll go sign up for a week, and you'll spend a week or sometimes two actually cutting a frame, erecting it, and taking it from start to finish. And it's a great way to learn if you're really into this stuff and want to get more. Hopefully, I'll just whet your appetite here. There's a ton of information here, and I'll try and keep it simple. And I'm going to let you guys ask questions because obviously we've got some woodworkers here, and I don't need to reteach you about the mortise and tenon. We'll do that real quick, but I'm going to let you guys kind of ask me what's going on as we're going along. I'm going to use this bent down here that Gerry taught us about. And we're going to put it together and show you how we put it together on site. And then hopefully that'll stir some questions. And I did want to take just a minute. First of all, I see we got a lot of veterans. Thank you. Thank you for your service. I appreciate that. Well, y'all do a great thing. Plant your garden here. I was a timber framer for 30 years. I'm now inheriting my family farm, and we used to do cows, so now I'm trying to turn it into agriculture. So if you're interested, I'm trying to kind of serve the North Atlanta, North Metro area. We're about 30 minutes north of Atlanta. And at this point, I'm just trying to get a feel for how many people want to plant their own and grow their own food.
Are you doing organic there, or?
Well, right now the fields are organic. We've never put anything out there, and chicken manure, and that's about it. And there's schools, and we're kind of one of the last cattle farms that encroached on by subdivisions, and so we got all these people that want to grow gardens, and they really can't. Covenants or whatever don't allow them to. So we could go back if you want to Gerry's. Some of his pictures, we can use some of his pictures up on the Jumbotron if y'all don't mind, and I can use that to point out some things as we go. Basic mortise and tenon, you guys got it. How you remember a mortise from a tenon? It's always Tommy Tenon, Mary Mortise. Parts of a tenon, you got your cheeks and your shoulders right here. Okay, tenons are easily cut with a saw. The cross grain can be cut with a saw. The rest, the cheeks, can be defined with chisels. You can just bust them out with chisels. You don't have to saw through that. It's with the grain if it's pretty straight grain. Another thing, y'all are probably used to working with a lot of dry wood, and typically most framers, certainly back in the day, when they first moved here, the frames were all green. They go out and they cut the trees right then. They hew them, they join them, and they get that barn up. That was the most important thing. Get their barn up and get their animals going. Then they could start working on a house. And back in the old country, they had pretty much had what's called, they followed one application of scribe, where they laid the timbers out and actually scribed each timber to another to build it. When settlers came over here, by this time they had basically, they had devised a framing square like this, but this is pretty much our God in the world. Everything revolves around a framing square. And you'll see, we'll do some creative things with it. You can use this for all kind of things, not just marking a square line. But some of the things, when we came over here, these guys came up with a methodology. The old way of timber framing was scribing, so they needed all their parts, and then had to have them all finished, lay them out together, and scribe them all together. Well, this enabled the certain guys to stay out in the woods, felling trees, another group of guys over here hewing the trees, and then you can have your joiners doing one piece, and they don't need any other piece to the frame. So it kind of made it almost generic, and they could basically, everything was an inch and a half layout, or 2 inch, inch and a half layout, depending on what the species of the wood was. Like if it was a softwood, a pine, typically they'd be 2 inch tenons laid out from a reference shoulder, 2 inches, so that'd be called a two and two layout. Even the peg location is defined by 1.5 times the diameter of the peg. So you got a 1 inch typical peg holding these joints together. So your layout for that is 1.5 inches. Now this piece of wood you can see is over 100 years old, and they use the same tool on it that we're using right now. So with the square rule, they were able to make this post, and this post could actually be generic throughout the frame. They could use it on bent one, bent two, any other bent. And we'll get into reference here. And this is our reference side here. If I were to turn this over, you see how it doesn't made up. It has some overhang there. That's what the reference And the 2-2 layout enables you to, that way if you're coming off center line, you know, and let's say you got your beam spun around, sometimes that can be confusing. But this gave it, you can almost see what's going on from across the shop with a piece of wood. I've seen people actually walk in, see a pile of wood and say, that second timber on row 2, look, something's wrong with that tenon. And this is why. I'm going to jump back to the bent and the bents and bays. The question was asked about the bent, and Gerald showed us about that. And let's back up to some of those pictures, and some of the common the typical spans that we tend to do are about 16 feet, and really because that's what local sawyers do. You pay a premium for anything over 16 feet. And quite a bit. A lot of times it's hard for the loggers to get long pieces of wood straight enough for what you need. So most spans are 16 feet. And like you saw on some of those, some of these pictures, come on back some, is that one of the first ones? All right, like this one is a scissor truss. And they were able to make that larger span because of that scissor truss. We also had some hammer beam trusses in there. So you had your, I'm going to do a hammer beam here. That allowed you to do an even larger span. And get away with, you should usually have a tie in here and a brace in there. And in most cases, they would sometimes have a shed or a buttress, some kind of aisle way out here, and tie it in right there. So that's your typical hammer beam. Some of that, that one right there, you see, that's hammer beam truss on top with an anchor beam across the bottom. That's kind of typical Dutch. Where they put a huge anchor beam, and they actually, if you were to look in there, that tenon would go all the way through. Sometimes they'd carve a little fancy detail on the end of those anchor beams. Let's see. Now the layout of these guys, I'm going to jump right into the format. If this is a plan view, let's find a simpler one. I'll try and copy
first one
on there. Well, let's go with that one. We've got a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 bent. So two bents make your bay, okay? Here's how you get your jointery marked in there. Everything always related back to the posts. And we'll start with the front. This would be like, this would be bent 1, this would be bent 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And then you see you've got some interior posts there, kind of like queen posts. And some of them actually don't even have both of those. So you may have one here, you may have another one over here. Sometimes they'll do them according to what their floor plan, what their interior walls are going to end up being. So what they do from this point is this front wall now becomes A, the next row becomes B, C, and D. So this post would be post 1A. This one here is 1B, 1C, 1D. This one here, 2A, 2C, 2D. In the old days, they would mark it with Roman numerals. So this would be bent 1, this would be bent 1, bent 2, bent 3, and such. They would come to the back of the building and go bent 1 with a tail, bent 2 with a tail, And if you look in these old buildings, they still have these carved nomenclatures on each piece, on the end of each piece. So by doing that, now you can see every connecting member in there can be related back to a post. So a beam that spans from B to C in bent one will be 1BC. And usually in different elevations, they will they'll have different size. Usually the lower tie members have to carry some kind of floor load or loft load. So the upper guys will be a smaller size. So sometimes they don't demarcate, you know, an upper from a lower. It may still be B to C. Like in this case here, you see that upper one at the very top triangle, it still spans kind of from B to C, but it's a small, like a 4x6, whereas the lower one's more like an 8x8. All right?
You said they would mark the ends of the beams. How would they do that?
They would actually chisel it in there with their chisel. And they would pop it with a chisel. Mark a one. And that was, anybody ever seen these race knives? They would have a race knife that is like a little gouge, had a handle, little bitty gouge on the end that kind of came off at a steep angle, about a 45. And they could just scratch their numbers with that race knife. Another thing, in France, they found some buildings. Well, actually, it was Scotland. They would mark like the front row with straight chisels. The back row, they would mark with gouges. So if you saw a post that had two marks, you knew it was a back post and bent two. And this one here would be a... It would just be a pop with the chisel or the gouge, whichever one. So everything relates. And then going the other way, once you've got your bents done, now you've got your connectors going from each one. So you're going to have a connector, which is going to be A12. So that gives you, that pretty much is it. And it's just that simple. All right? Any questions?
How'd they deal with wood rot on the pieces and up close to the ground back then?
Species of wood, like the woods that have tannin in them, like the white oak, the post oak, bur oak, locust was a good one. Osage orange, I don't think they ever had timbers large enough to build with like that, but that was how they dealt with the insects.
Chestnut way back then.
Absolutely, chestnut was great. We kind of forget about chestnut because we don't ever see it anymore. Mm-hmm. Huge ones. And but certainly, you know, they cutting these things green and getting them up in the building, they didn't have to worry about bugs too much. And even if you did get bugs, here you've got this 10 by 10 or 8 by 8 posts, and back then everything was odd numbers. It was like the posts were typical 9 by 9s, beams were 9 by 11s, small girts were 5 by 7s. And it would take a long time for those to rot anyway. So it was, and some of them did rot away. It took 100, 200 years. But as evidenced in England and all throughout Europe, they've been standing for hundreds of years. There's covered bridges that have been up for 600, 700 years in Holland.
The verticals were actually in the ground, buried in the ground?
Some of them were. I did take a barn down in Kentucky that was 200 years old that had center eastern red cedar posts that were about 4 feet in the ground. And it was a tapered post. They were like 30 feet long. Went from like an 11 by 11 to a 9 by 9 at top. And
when did Chris come along?
I'd say 20th century.
Yeah.
You know, they say like the yellow pines, when you they kind of secrete their own creosote, but it doesn't. Here in the South, I just say everything rots. If it doesn't kill you, it'll rot. We've got all the insects you can imagine. So you know, no wood lives outside here in the South. I do find locust fence posts that have been in the ground on the farm for well over 100 years, and they're still as solid as any pressure-treated we put in there.
The farmers in Pennsylvania, when they look up there, they cut black locust logs, and they stick them right in the ground.
Right in the ground.
Put the fence up, and it stands for hundreds of years.
They say it'll last longer than 100 years, longer than stone. Go ahead.
I do the codes and stuff like the zoning laws.
Yes, sir.
What effect does that have on these?
Well,
are they alike?
You know, it was like pulling teeth to get local building trades to accept it. They would pretty much ignore it as part of the frame, and they wanted to see the what they understood as the framing, because you always have an enclosure system of some sort around the frame. And the way some of them would be infill, and infill would be if I'm still looking on a plan view. These are two posts, and here's my beam above. An infill would come in, they would stud, or in the old day it was called waddle and daub, and they would run, it would be a dowel, that they would just drill a hole in the beam above, a little one in the floor, stick this sapling in there, and then they would have riven, smaller saplings that they had rived out for small strips that they would weave in there. So in the old days, it would look like this, little saplings in there, and then they weave this riven stock in there, and then they would come and daub mud on both sides. So that was waddle and daub. Today, some people, like in England, you see a lot of those are waddle, most of them are waddle and daub. It exposes the timbers on the outside as well as the inside. They get away with it because their temperatures are down. Plus, English oak is a lot like our white oak. It's got a lot of tannin in it, and it can survive the kind of elements that like red oak's not going to handle here. So this would be called an infill system, and you could still do this with studs. All right. The other enclosure system is just coming out here. You would have a step, basically like a brick ledge on your foundation, and you would have a whole other stud frame stood up on the outside of your timber frame. And same, you could probably get away with 2 foot centers. But like I said, it was like pulling teeth to get the timbers worked into the structure of the things with the local codes.
So with local codes, I think Wayne was really talking about ground contact with your posts. Local codes, ground contact, you've got to use some type of pressure, and it has to be over a certain size. I think it's 4x4 posts. How do you handle it with these?
Well,
are they actually like
codes
or something?
Well, codes are not going to let us put any wood below around here, I think 18 inches above grade, that's not pressure treated. So most of the timber frame posts set on a wood foundation to begin with. So they're already up, 2x12 or 2x10, and that's where the timber frame posts. If you're on a slab, you'll have a standoff, typical some kind of steel or stainless steel standoff. We don't ever try and get concrete in connection with it. Don't ever let concrete touch our wood. As far as on the slabs, I don't know what the codes are as far as that's concerned. I'm pretty much a traditionalist. Ted Benson's book, I will point out, he was like one of the first guys that started the revival of timber frame back in the 60s. Today he is the cutting edge. They're CNC machines that do all of this work now. So it's pretty much put all of the little guys out of business.
You said never let it touch cement. Will cement be constant damp and make it rot or what?
Exactly. I mean, they say it takes cement 70 years to cure, so that wood is always wicking that moisture from that cement. And it's the combination of water and air that rots wood. And sun is its own killer.
So you build it down, it's still not cured, they say.
There you go. You got a question?
I just wonder where they harvest all this wood. If it's all over the United States, or is there specific areas that they draw from?
Yes, everywhere. From Florida, from the swamps of Florida and Georgia, BC, Alaska, we get Alaskan yellow cedar and big Doug fir up there. BC's a big lumber producer. Ohio, Indiana, they're big with the hardwoods. We get a lot of red oaks, maples, white oaks out of that area.
Osage orange, I guess.
Yeah. Very few. In fact, there's an Osage orange mallet. A friend of mine had just turned this. And that is the color it is. And it always stays that color, too. Like poplar, you all know when you cut in a nice, hardy piece of poplar, all the colors, the purples and everything, and then it's gone after a few hours when the air hits it.
Mike, the problem with Osage orange, and I saw a lot of it in Pennsylvania, it doesn't get big enough or a little straight enough to make a beam out of it.
It's kind of like locust. It really is a weed.
Cypress
is an excellent, very bug resistant, but it'll still rot. It'll still rot if things aren't looked after. I built an arbor off a big house down on the coast of South Carolina, and they let wisteria grow up and cover it like a lattice, so it made shade. Well, you know, these big live oaks, it kept dumping leaves, and after about 3 years, it had a big mat of mulch on it and steamy south, and I'm talking 10-inch diameter logs in this little arbor, and they just melted. They just rotted within 5 years, and it was cypress. Now, there's a difference between I understand that the bald cypress is really the cypress that you want to use. There's a black cypress, and you know, once it's cut and the leaves are gone, I can't tell the difference.
When you buy cypress commercially, it's generally bald cypress.
Just cypress.
No, it's generally bald cypress.
Oh, they call it bald cypress. Okay.
No, but I mean, that's what it is when you get into it.
Okay.
It's normally gotten out of the swamps down here.
Yeah. There's a huge difference in heartwood and sapwood and cypress as far as rot resistance is concerned.
Especially like on the eastern.
What you want, but it's
yeah. Yeah. But it's, well, I don't know. It's white. Is you know the difference in colors?
Oh yeah, the sapwood is a lot lighter colored.
Yeah, mine's light white.
Yeah.
And I've gotten a lot of it. The other thing was totem poles. I don't think have been northwest. Totem poles, they'll rot it.
What was that?
Totem poles.
Totem poles?
You don't find them. You know, I thought they'd be all over the place, and apparently they're not, and I think they just rot.
Because they rot. Yeah. I think they carved them out of mostly Doug fir.
Yeah, and they checked and split in the weather, too, so because they're sitting.
You bet. So, like, eastern red cedar, we use a lot of western red cedar, you know, for porches around here, but eastern red cedar is really that aromatic cedar, but that sapwood on it will slough off just as quick as you please, like that one, that barn I took down in Kentucky. 3 feet in the ground, the heartwood was there, but the sapwood was completely gone. Yes?
So, how do they make their pegs? Just literally carving them with a knife?
They would split them out, and usually the pegs ended up, and I don't want to go too far on that, but the cutoffs usually served as the best pegs. And the cutoff, they'd have this timber, or they'd cut it to length, and usually they'd start out with about an 18-inch, 2-foot piece of firewood. And they'd just take an axe, throw, and split it out just like they would their shingles, and put it on a shaving horse and draw knife it. And I'll pass some of these around. I've got brought some different kinds of pegs. I've got two riven. Actually, I'm going to pass. Three of them are riven. One of them is sawn octagon, and two more are professionally turned. And the thing about the sawn wood, one of the critical things is you want straight grain. If you have grain that goes off at an angle, like if here's your peg, and your grain is running like this, there is a chance if your holes are too tight and you drive it, you can shear it, and then you're driving this peg to the side of that one, it'll split your timber up. So ribbon is the best. Absolutely, they have to be dry, and usually they would dry them by you know, when they were living by the fire, whatever it took. It's and typically they're hardwood, but I have seen them all in heart pine. I did a restoration in Charleston on the market hall, and every one of those pegs, it was heart pine trusses, heart pine pegs. And so that does bring us, I can tell you this, if you like dry jointery, is gonna, like we do most of our furniture in it, it's gonna hold up better, it's gonna stay tight, it's gonna keep the piece of furniture as it acclimates and dries. If it's green, then that joint's gonna loosen up. And that's why, I mean, you've always, everybody's taken a chair out to the shed or something, or brought something back. If you leave it outside, it's nice and tight. You bring it inside, all of a sudden it's kind of wobbly. Well, it's just taking on the ambient humidity and drying out that much more. So there are things that we do in timber framing that we can stop that from happening, even in green wood. But if you like really tight jointery, you know, you definitely want to go for the dry pegs. You want to try for your dry tenons. And the last to be dried is your mortises or your posts. Okay? That way, in fact, there's a chair builder, Brian Boggs, in North Carolina, does some beautiful ladder back chairs. And he was talking about how he specifically picks his legs green stock, and all his rail stock is always kiln dried to like 6%. And he says it just makes for a tight, that mortise shrinks as the legs dry. It tightens up on that tenon and just makes them tight as can be.
Now, when you're dealing with wet, are you draw boring the holes?
Good point. Absolutely, and that's an old technique. And when y'all come up here, you can take a look at this sample here, and that's exactly what they did. In fact, why don't y'all just come on up and we'll start putting this guy together, and I can show you this because I've got some examples here. I want you to see. Come on up here.
Is there a lot of movement in the wood?
We're going to do layout right in here. Ton of movement. And depending on the species, more movement than not. Yellow pine, notorious. Red oak, notorious.
You might have a hard time if you start putting one together and you only work on the weekends. You know, put it together and come back to work on the next stage.
That's right.
It's facing the other direction.
and that's hence the importance of getting the building done and up as quick as you can. Absolutely. But as y'all can see here, with my framing square, this was a 2-2 layout. It's a little shrunk, but it's still using the framing square. And this is still, if you can see the line here, they set their framing square and they just took a scribe and scribed along that line to show where they're going to peg this thing. So they, with the square rule concept, they could actually drill their mortises and drill their tenons on the sawhorse and put it together and not have to have it together to drill this tenon. And you see, that's exactly what they did. If you look at the scribe and how they moved it in about a quarter inch.
Yeah, you might mention that those holes are quite often offset to draw them.
And that's what the question was. Do they draw bore? And this is, I'm just showing you that they did, and they did for hundreds of years. Y'all see that offset from there just a little bit? Mm-hmm. So in today's work, a lot of people, you know, by the time they get to the raising and they want to, they don't, you know, They will be meticulous on stuff. They will get the job done. And you'll see them, they'll just call this pull and bore. They'll just pull the frame together and then just run through all the mortises and punch all the holes. Well, if it's a green frame, it's going to shrink, it's going to loosen up. And it's taken years getting back to the code thing. With the guild, we were able to finance the study at Dr. Dick Schmidt out of, let's say, University of Wyoming. He actually had us build frames or bents, and he would stand them up in his laboratory and he would apply hydraulics to them, and he would tear these bents up. He would try and rip these tenons apart, and he got it down to exact engineering. So now when an engineer or an inspector is asked about a certain aspect, we can show them the specs. This will allow for this. But in today's technology with this stuff, let's pass some of these around. Y'all can be looking at some pegs. With today's technology, they say, getting back to the enclosure system. Well, let me keep one of those. You'll see the difference of the turn peg and the ribbon. They say the other aspect of, let me get right here, of the enclosure, if you don't want to do stud, you can do what's called SIPs, or structural insulated panels. And they're just a prefabricated panel, the same thing, it'll set like on a brick ledge, but they just bring that in, it'll come in 8 foot by 40 foot sections if that's how you want to order it. And they say in actuality, once a timber frame is paneled with these panels, you should be able to take, and that's what the panels are engineered to, take the frame out from underneath it. And it'll still be a structural building. And good jointery in a timber frame, they say, once the frame is up, all the pegs really did was keep the bents and frame parts together during erection. You should be able to just pull the pegs right out and the frame still stand. So we've come a long way with a lot of the engineering, although so on this guy, if y'all look here, did a standard 2, and since this was oak, did a 2-inch, inch and a half layout. With the oak, it didn't need the larger tenons. So you see, this was all laid out. And, you know, that's not gospel. I definitely want to tell you, it's a matter of consistency. If you like laying out with a marking gauge, someone come with 2 bars, 2 little things, and you can set it at 2 and 1.5 inches or 2 and 2. And as long as you stuck with that same marking system throughout the frame, you'll be fine.
Which that technique goes back thousands of years. Like, yeah, I think even the Greeks would have a plate that would have a foot and a span and a rod and everything on the plate, so everybody could come out and calibrate their tools to the same measurements. So everybody that was on the site were all using the same references.
There you go. And reference is the biggest point right there. In doing this, when we have our plans, we have reference faces, and because our tooling has a table on it, that table has to reference something. I mean, every one of our shop things, we've got a table saw, it's got a table, it's got a fence. Those are references. So on the frame, I'm going to blow this corner up right here. Here's this post. Typically, they're 8x8. We will have a reference. Outside is always the reference. And then as you're going through the frame, so this would be the reference here, and this would be the reference here. And we actually draw that on the timber, and we'll get to one of those like that. And like some of the old buildings, they found that they would reference towards the thrashing bay. So like if this is where they came, they would stack hay here. This may be the gray area over here, and the horses would come in sometimes and out the door like that with the wagon, and they would thrash, they'd pull the maybe the wheat stalk out off of here and they'd thrash it on the floor here. So what they would do in that case is they would have all the references facing the thrashing bay. And that was kind of typical in northern barns. But still, on the outside, it was still the same reference. Okay? So now we've got something that we reference our framing square to. And so one of the first things that we do, I'm gonna do it on this piece right here. So you got the concept, even if you want to use a combo square, or I'll show you something that we use a lot of. And I brought some of these. Y'all are welcome to some of these. You got broken tape, cut them a foot long past the foot mark. Now you got a foot long ruler that you can throw all over the shop. If you lose it, you haven't lost a thing. And I haven't had time to take it to the grinder, but I just take it to a little disc grinder and take it to the line and round the corner. Be careful, these ends are sharp, but y'all are welcome to some of these if you want. You probably have a tape at home, or
so you're doing.
You can do that.
Over on each end.
An inch over, so I can actually read, because it gives you the 1 inch, 1 inch, 2 inch, 3 inch, 4 inch. So it's a good foot ruler. Okay, I don't ever use it for, you know, maybe checking depth. Not a big deal. And typically we would always go deeper on our mortises than our tenons. Posts tended to be 8 inches long, so ideally tenons were 3 3/4. That would allow for shrinkage of that post in there. Okay.
So when you're draw boring, what's your offset from the hole in your tenon?
Depending on what the species was. If it was a pine, I'd maybe go 3/16 in an oak. I've actually taken pegs out that did that number, and I've seen half a hole offset, so as much as up to a half in some frames. If you've got long enough, this is what you got to remember. This is the structural part of the tenon right there, that end grain, that grain that runs from the sides of the holes. That's where you're putting that pressure. That's where you'll get that failure if the tenon can't hold. So if you apply too much of a draw bore, you'll either bust that out or you'll split right here at the post. But that seemed to work. The 1.5 times peg diameter always seemed to work just fine. The other part is, we're not spending, usually when I do a class, I'll spend half the class just talking about timber framing. Timber, because timber's half of timber framing. And you got to understand what the wood's doing and what the wood can and what the wood can't do. And some of the critical things you got to remember in structure. Wood works well in compression, does not work well in tension. Okay? You can't peg this into a joint and expect to put huge forces pulling it out of that post. And like Gerry showed us on that one bent we had here, I'm just going to keep it simple right now. If force is applied to the side here, what's going to happen is that's going to put this brace in compression. This brace will virtually fall right out. As a matter of fact, barns that were done in Ohio, I want to say towards the latter end, they started to understand this to the point where they didn't even peg the braces. And they didn't even have a standard 3-inch tenon on the braces. It didn't matter because they only worked in compression. So, and that was something in the hammer beam like you saw before. This will be your hammer beam, this will be your hammer post. These lower braces here are in tension in a hammer beam, because this frame is wanting to splay out. So these tend, and in some cases we do a floating spline, like a plywood spline, that we can actually run through the post, through a mortise in the post, and up through just a running mortise in the brace itself. These braces here are in compression, but there are times where some things need to be added, and a standard mortise and tenon won't act in tension, and we have to make wooden tension jointery. In the old days, they always just buttressed off with an aisle or something like that, or maybe with masonry. That's how they dealt with it back then. So we've gotten quite innovative with some of the stuff. But one of the big things, Ted Benson, who author of the classic, I'm not sure if it was the classic, the Brown Book there, Keep It Simple, Stupid. That's all, KISS. And it's the mortise and tenon is the basic joint, and that's what we try to stick with. And I will show you some other joints. What you see here on this mortise right here is a housing. If we needed more bearing for a beam, and here's your mortise in here, we would cut a housing so that tenon would actually, the timber would set on some kind of ledge. If this member here actually had some force applied to it. And let's say you have one coming from both sides, and you find that we've diminished this, and we can only get a little bitty tenon in here and a little bitty tenon in here, something that will give you more wood and still give you bearing, we'll do what's called a diminished haunch. Okay, and that allows you to cut further into the wood if you needed more of a ledge, like if you needed an inch and a half ledge. I mean, it all comes down to square inches of surface area and what it's supporting. Okay. The other thing, getting back to the draw bore. So if the mortise was drilled right there, and we offset the tenon back here, we added wood to the end of the tenon itself, we would also do the same thing upwards. I would raise it up. So if this is your mortise hole, here's your center line here and here, I would not only come over, but I would come up with this hole. That means as this shrank from here to that line there, it would keep forcing it down as well as in. If you didn't do that, if you just did a draw bore straight across and it's green, then this is going to shrink and you'll lose that bearing, and we got what's called peg bearing joinery. Okay? The other thing about this barn was done, you can still see the circular marks in it. What was I getting at here with this? This is what's called, well, I won't say it's quite quarter sawn. I won't get into the aspects of it. The middle part of the tree is like rubber. So, and they called that the pith. And one of the important things is it had no structural integrity. So if you have a timber, usually what we shoot for, and getting back to your movement in your timbers, the ideal timber is going to be what's called boxed heart. There's your heart. It's dead center on the wood. If you get a piece of wood like this, here was your heart. And this is pretty typical when you get a 6x12, they'll take a big tree, they'll cut a 12x12, and then they'll split it. And every time what'll happen is, here's your tree, if you split it, the heart will go back to the heart. So those pieces will just banana on you. The other kind of sawn piece is, your heart's over here, it's called rift sawn. this is banana in two different directions, okay? So you got another, everything's in three dimensions. You've got, even the tree itself has grains that you've got tangential grains, you have radial grains, and you have lengthwise grains running within that tree. So every one is creating its own characteristic. And the other thing about the timber, and why I want to get to it, is when you get a stick delivered on a truck, you really don't know how it came out of the woods. And what's happened, you know why you crown your timber? It's because when that tree was growing in the forest, it had some kind of adversity it had to overcome, be it growing on a hillside or growing on the north side of a slope or any number of reasons. And maybe a mountain blocked the sun from here, and all of a sudden it got all the late day sun and kind of formed these, make these trees twist. In the timber, once you've got a timber sawn, you've got what's called the neutral axis, which is straight through the middle of that timber. And this is, I'm using this in its building application. As you load the top, that's why you crown your timbers, because when it grew, part of that tree grew in compression and formed compression grain, and part of the tree formed tension grain. And once that went through the saw, relieved a lot of that pressure, and even though it sawed out straight, by the time it had a chance to acclimate, it took a bow or it took a crown or something like that. And the point being of me showing you this, here's your neutral axis right down the middle, and it goes from compression wood is your upper section and your tension wood is your lower section. And usually some of the best, if I had a 2x4, if I cut halfway through that 2x4 on top and then put a little wedge in it, I could still put pressure on it. If I cut up from the bottom and put a wedge in it, I put pressure and just break right away. Yeah. Okay? So that kind of tells you what your tension grain and your compression grain is. So understanding that is really critical to a lot of what you do here. Any questions? We'll put this bent together. I know we're getting close on time, guys. Y'all can please ask questions, whatever you need to. Absolutely.
You gonna swing this way with it?
We'll work right here. Now this cart enables me to kind of do it easily by myself, and sometimes having a helper doesn't help. And when you're cutting off your timbers, we always buy our timbers 2 foot longer. You never know if you've added, you know, if your posts are 8 foot, you're going to have a tenon on top, tenon on bottom. So you always, we don't get it right on the money. And real quick, if y'all are ever going to do a project with this, push, pull, roll, pivot, slide, whatever you need to, don't pick the timber up, if at all. There's so many ways you can roll the timber around. Alright, if I need to get it somewhere, if I need to move a heavy timber, I can maybe jack one side with a board like that, and then roll it, and then I can position it in if I'm a little off. I've worked on like 60 foot, 24 by 24 pieces of wood, and we would actually make a wheel and attach it to that timber. So as we laid it out, we just rolled just had the whole floor open. You could just roll the whole timber.
Sometimes when they're felling the tree, if it's wide open where they are, and it actually slaps the ground, they get a shock fracture.
Absolutely. That would be.
How did they handle that 100 years ago?
Well, usually they got the limbs and they've got a good forest bed to come down on, and that takes the shock. But where it gets that felling fracture is where they fell the tree, felled another one on top of it. So you can get, and it's notorious in white pine, you can find these as you're planing. You're running your planer across and you see this faint little line. It's finer than a hair.
Yeah.
And that's a felling shear. Also, another thing that can happen is felling shake. And shake is where the actual ring separates from another ring in the tree. So it's almost two pieces. It's not bound together still. And sometimes falling against another tree bends it and creates that shake in there. Those are some of the things that grading, they look at in a tree and they'll either kick it or...
Well, this hasn't happened to me.
Yeah.
But sometimes when you're turning the bowl and you get into a felling shock or a shake, it'll explode.
Yeah.
Yeah. Blade, so.
Just gone.
It hadn't happened to me.
And that can happen naturally, not falling. I mean, it can happen, let's say they had a bad year. They had a drought. That'll create a
fire damage.
That'll create fire. A forest fire will create just that little void, that little interruption in its life. Maybe a bad season of some kind of insect or something. Mm-hmm. So, like you see, having cutoffs is not a bad thing because we use them. We use them all the time. I showed you the housings. I showed you the layout, the two-two. Braces, when we lay out braces, they're typically laid out on a whole number basis because you're going to have three times to do dimensions. And it's easier to keep, because you're going to have this leg to do as well as this leg to do of the brace. And the brace will be the diagonal between the two. So keep it simple. You know, make it a simple 2 foot, 30 inch, 32, 36, whatever. And then the only exacting measurement is the length of the brace itself. So we're going to put this guy together and y'all see a lot of what's happening here. Let's get rid of this cart. Here's another one of our things for rolling timbers. We'll use a peavey. Certainly if it's rough sawn, we don't really care. If it was a S4S finished frame and we don't want to mar up the surface at all, we'll make a timber wrench. You can just make it out of plywood or 2x4 and just make it about a quarter inch bigger than the size of stock that you're having to roll and use that for rolling. Another, if you've got your jointery, another way to roll this, stick a 2x4 in there and roll that over, okay? Anything to give you a little bit of advantage other than this. That's the worst thing you can do. And even still, we do a lot of picking up. So, you know, pick it up as always with the legs, back straight, keep it as close to the body as you can when you have to pick up, okay? Some of the things that can happen to you, I'll just tell you real quick. You still have timbers on the sawhorse. You still got to manipulate them. You still got to roll them around and move them. Some of the damage that you can do to yourself, if this were really a big timber, if I were to catch this, use my fingers and catch it right there in my fingers to roll, even if I'm using my hips, and that's what I'll do in most cases. When I have my hands up in there, try and roll everything is done with the legs if I can. Okay? I know this is a little piece, but I can roll that a lot easier. If I'm using my hands, I want to actually catch it in the meaty part of my palm, because you'll sever nerves in your fingers. Constantly rolling. And that's the thing, maybe doing your one home project, you're not going to hurt yourself so bad. You'll be tired, you'll be sore. But when you do it over and over for 30 years, Every time you pick up a timber, you're squishing those discs, and it can really lead to some chronic problems. So, and another one of my biggest fans is the hearing protection. And the reason I love these is because when you're cutting, most of us use skill saws to cut these tenons. And these tenons are right here. So I am, actually my face is right up into that skill saw. And skill saw is every bit as loud as any tool in a shop. And you are right in it. So I've always been religious with these, and I can still hear. So I think it did me good. Yeah. There you go. Okay, so here we go. Let's get this situated in here. We're going to leave that one out. Now let's just slide that guy in here. That's it. Gerald, do you want to get that in for me? Okay. One of the first things to remember in jointery layout, a 2-inch mortise will not fit in a 2-inch hole. Okay. Two planes cannot occupy the same space. So either your tenon's 2 inches and your hole's a little bigger, or your hole's 2 inches and your tenon's a little smaller. Now these braces are what's called side tenons. And now, you know, they could have been applied. I could have cut my post and my beam, squared it up, cut a brace like this, and then laid it up on the side there, and maybe just cut that notch in there. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's just called a lap brace. And that's as effective as any. It still works in compression. But these are mortised. And always get your pieces kind of started before you come together with it. Here's the other thing, if you do your jointery too tight, then you gotta beat it with something like this. And we try not to.
They have a name for that. It's called a beetle. Just a big mallet. They actually use it for squaring up a frame too. And just hammer on one side of it and square it up.
So we manually put our bits together, and we get them close and get them where they're started in their holes. And that's really all we do at that point. And that can actually come out of there. And this is always good exercise for timber framers. One of the first things you do is learn how to work a come along. So we don't ever take a loop like this and loop it, because we're going to leave this on here. When we raise this bent up, we're going to leave our come alongs on, take as much pressure off of the pegs. We don't want to rely on the pegs doing all that work. And what the raising of this thing is not what these bents are designed for. So like I said, the pegs hold the jointery together while it's being raised. So the bent will never be under any more force than when it's being stood up. So we leave our come-alongs on it. The reason I don't do this, these timbers might go on before I know it, before I've had a chance to strip it, and it's there. The only way to get them off is with a knife. So what we do is we choke them, That's called a choke. It's called a basket. You know, if that's what you want to do, you can do a basket. Anyway, like that shortens the strap up a little bit, and that gives you a little bit more length. Jim, if you wrap that on there. Well, they had block and tackle back in the day, but I think this was mainly their biggest tool. And let's go underneath here. And then let's say, you know, you did this green, and this post has started to twist. I can actually take this choke and put it to the side that I want to retwist that post back to, if that's how I cut my jointery. But in this case, we should be good. I'm going to come straight across. I'm going to give myself a little... go with a little bit longer. If you need longer length, I'll say don't do this, but you see me doing it. You can always tie these together and stick a peg in there. Now you can put some force on it and then you can take it apart afterwards. These are locusts. Oh, the straps. It's a nylon sheath with straight nylon core. Individual strands, they're not braided or anything in there. Ashley, Sling, lots of places around here. There's like three different places, and they make them up for you. You know, I think they just pounded it together. You know, it was more such a necessity than it was, you know, having gorgeous work. And if you do
ropes and block and tackle
is good. Probably a lot like what the Egyptians had to do when they built those big stones and had to jack them into place. So we just set everything by hand. Just get it barely started and then let things like this do the work. And in this case, I would have had a 2x4 that is the same length here that I can attach to my feet. Put in between these tenons down here. These tenons will be going into a sill, and then that tenon will take a plate that the rafters will sit on. So I can't come any farther with that table there. Another thing that they did use these, just a marlin spike. If you're already drilled, you can use that to jack that around. You can actually drive it in and pull it out afterwards. And we're probably catching somewhere. Start. There it goes. And I believe that square that one up.
Needs to go in.
Yeah, that post bottom go down. Let's use the old commander on it. The other thing about the square rule aspect is you can do a part. And then you can pre-fit it, like these braces, you have a brace cut and you can fit it into that mortise if you want. There were other people, shops that I knew, that they would just go through their frame, they would cut their posts and their beams. They would put them together, lay the whole system out. They'd lay the whole wall system out, 50 feet long, 60 feet long, whatever, post, all the beams. Then they would take their braces, like that one I showed you, like if I was going to do just the lap out here with the tenon, they would set it on their mark, and they would actually do a mortise. But that brace, and then they could, that what that did was allowed them to find the best place of that bearing, where the shoulders were actually meeting the faces good. And they could, so they could cheat a little bit here and here. If this post had a little tweakage to it, a little bow, maybe this had a little more crown than they wanted. And they could actually fit that brace, and then they'd mark it, pull it apart, mortise that in, stick the brace in, mark it for draw bore. You know, and they'd just be drilling their tenons at that point. All right, so that's still not together all the way. And that's probably what I can do. Gerald, if you'll stand on here, yeah. I'm going to try. Can that help? No. I could have these braces. Now these are old braces out of an existing building. They're the original tenons on there. These pieces are recycled, but they've been remilled, resawn, and resurfaced. So that's why this is perfectly square. And while I got that, that's one of the things when you got this. You got these 16-foot long timbers on your sawhorse. One of the first things you want to do when you lay that out, you want to find the shape of this log. And that means, am I twisted? And by using two framing squares, I can look down the tops of these and I can see any kind of twist in there.
That's a line of stick contact.
Yep, and that's ancient. And then I always carry me a little assortment of wedges. So I'll find what makes them parallel, perfectly parallel. And then I'll measure down. If I have, getting back to our reference, it's nice if you can use the face as the reference, the outside faces. If you're twisted or warped or really out of square, what we'll do is mark, you'll find your squarest side and make that your two reference sides. And if you need to, you unwind it with framing squares like this or winding sticks, and you come down a given amount and pop a line, and that becomes your reference on there. All right? Let's see, where else are we here? Let me show y'all a quick little trick while we got that thing together. This is using some of the new technology. You want to cut a round brace in there.
Braces don't have to be square.
A lot of people love it. Love to have this round stuff.
In whole buildings, it's all round.
See, now look what I can do. I can line that face up with that. And usually I have this stood off of here with a little block and strapped in. Now I can actually pencil that perfect 45 cut, and then I can turn it over here and pencil this one in as well. Okay, and then I can go to the other side. because I'm only going to get this front surface, I can go to the other side, get that back surface. How cool is that?
It's a lot easier than describing it and hoping.
Exactly.
Back and forth.
And good, that'd be a good point to introduce Mr. Scribe. Mr. Scribe here. Veritas has them. I'm sure they've got them out on the floor there. So, the old days, they just had a forked stick. And they'd have a piece of ochre, you know, some kind of charcoal or something, and they'd follow that forked stick around, tracing. Basically, all scribes do is they create a plumb bob in midair, wherever you go. Because as I've got this set up, now I'm on a nice level floor. When they did the frames using scribe, they would have to mock this up in the field. And usually, in the old days, they did. They had what was called a lofting floor. And they still do that style of building in boats to loft up the planks. And they don't use these, but I'm sure they use something sort of like this. I'm not a boat builder. This basically, pointer on one end, that's going to guide against, and a pencil on the other. And I set this up level, and what I'll do is I'll take two pieces of wood and make a little right angle. Make a little right angle thing like this, and clamp it to a doorway or a tree if I'm outside, and I can put a screw on one side, maybe wedge the other side, and I can get the aris there, that inside line, perfectly plumb. And then I bring my scribe over, and what I have to do with my scribe is create my reference lines, okay? And as basically, your reference lines would be if I were to take my level, come down that known distance that I did here, let's say go ahead and make it the center. Usually if we have to do an offset reference, we'll make it part of the jointery. Like if it's a 2-inch layout, we'll make it 4 inches or make it 2 inches in. That way we can use that as our layout. And then I'll actually do a level line and a plumb line, and then if it's green, it will be green, run to the other end before it twists and do the same thing. And then I can connect those two end crosshairs, and that gives me my reference plane, and all I'm going for is that aris down the middle. Now, at any point when I set this piece up, and this did have it, you can see the ink lines on here. I set this up. I make it perfectly level. I make this perfectly level. And this being together, we know we're the same height. Now that everything's mocked up perfectly level, now I can take that distance that I've got from this center line. If I want this to be in the center, I'll take the distance, center line here to center line here, make that the distance on my scribe here. And I'll now go up to my little plumb station that I had, and I'll adjust my bubble back here to a bubble going this way and a bubble going this way. And sometimes you can adjust them just moving the pencil in a little bit or pushing it out, but you got to maintain that distance. Because what you scribe, that's how far down it'll come, okay? And then I just follow, watching my bubbles, keeping my pointer against that stick, I'll make that mark in that round guy. Now, this is a affordable scribe, which you can see what happens if I do it on this side. You see how far I get. I really can't go much farther because either the way the pencil's sharpened or something. And if you're really crazy about this kind of work, you can spend a boatload of money. And you know it's all about the tools, right?
Right.
Okay, so these guys were geniuses. They took a plotter pin and they put it on an axis, a rotating axis here. So now I do the same thing. I get my distance. I go up to my level station. I level it this way. And in this case, I have a bullseye bubble. And it's got a tripod little screws there, a round wrench. So I zero those bubbles in, do it that way, and then I turn them 90 and do them that way. I can turn this over. You see I've got different approaches here. I can go here and here. That's why they give me two bubbles on here. Now I can take this guy and actually scribe up and over a round log like that. So that's this is used a lot with log builders. It helps them. That's what's called, what happens here, this is called recurve. Some tools just can't get you there from here. This one can. So those are the systems. There's a couple other systems, tumbling and stuff like that, that people have come up with, and that's kind of a system where they had a 2-foot stick and they marked, like I could just take this square here and scratch a line here, and then know that I'm 2 inches over, and then I have to move this crooked line if this was a out of square timber. And I do that with this timber. I saw this purposefully out of line so I could show you French scribe. And basically, if you guys still like this, you like what you're seeing, I'll go on with an old style French scribe, which all they used was a plumb bob and a caliper. And like I said, they would have a lofting floor, and they would have that frame, the reference faces, pop a line popped on the floor. So you'd have a line on the outside reference face here, top side of this beam across there, and it would be perfectly square. So they set their timbers up over it. Now this would be stacked over it, right? I don't have a tenon in there. They would line this up like this, and then see if I can kind of get where everybody can see here. What this lets you do is, if this were sitting on the timber, you can get it where these guys can maybe see some there too. Now, imagine I'm mocked up on here. I'm level, I got my center lines. So you see what this does? It gives you how much this is out of square. And then in the French scribe methodology, they take that distance right there and transfer it down to the other piece below. And so there's this tool, and they use a pencil. And we'll talk about that real quick. This is how I sharpen my pencil, and not because I learned that from these guys that French scribe, because this is the other part of the tool. They need to be able to transfer and eyeball that surface with the face of this timber. I know it sounds complicated, but once you do it, it's easy. And like I'm telling you, Jack Sobin, did one of those books there, he's more of a traditionalist. Ted has the CNC machine. He has all the engineers. Jack loves the tradition, and he is a licensed architect and engineer. So, but he still prefers doing everything by hand, and he'll use this system. And so this being your eyeball and being able to look at that timber coming across and transfer that point over to here, that's what that's all about. Now this, we had plumb bobs. What they had back then, what they'll use is like a pancake shape saucer. They call it a plumette. And it's got crosshairs in the middle. So it's big and wide, and you can't see around it, but you can see through it. And they're able to get, not only does it cut the wind as the wind's blowing, it doesn't blow around like a plumb bob does, and they can see through to line their crosshairs up. So they use a plumette. They don't use a plumb bob like this. Another thing I wanted to show you guys real quick. I can take, I always have two of these. One's, you know, winding sticks. You want a caliper. You want to be able to see how square a timber is. You know, you can use it like that. You can put little stair gauges on here. Now, this only works on the steel gauges.
They make levels too that'll attach to those.
And this is good if you have to do like let's say I'm on a non-reference face and I want to make a mark on a non-reference face. Well, I'm going to reference off a reference face here, right? Bring these in just a little. So I can reference any way from the sides here. I can catch another reference face here. I can catch this reference face from non-reference face from that side. But I can't really do anything from here, but by doing that, that allows me to do some marking underneath here if I need to. Be it a through mortise or something, let's say I've got a mortise laid out here and it's a crooked timber, then I can actually lay out a reference to that through mortise on the other side and hit it right on the money. Okay? So that's a good little tool. What else what did I leave off here, Jerry? The post drill. That's how we do our mortises. Now, we definitely have
two or three of them, right? Actually, I don't own one.
If you like doing it the hard way, this is one way to do it. But we lay out our mortise, and then we'll take a chisel, we'll pop the ends of it, and then we'll usually mark a center line, and we'll just go to town drilling. It's a self-feed bit, pulls itself down. You don't have to pull on this or anything, and it'll drill that hole on the ends, and you just do a series of holes all the way down your mortise, and then you take your inch and a half chisel. And like Jerry was showing you, he's got an inch and a half chisel. I don't mess around with the 2-inch chisel. It's just too big. Inch and a half axes everything.
It's slick over there, though.
I do have a slick, and I have a 2-inch chisel, but I find I use my inch and a half because I'll touch on sharpening a little bit. When you sharpen your edge tools, the flat is what's critical. The angle is what you sharpen for whatever kind of wood you're cutting on, hardwood, softwood, recycled, whatever. Where you get that final edge is that flat lap. And I carry different grits, and I carry 2 stones of every grit. And I hone my stones as much as I hone my blades. I probably spend more time keeping my stones flat. That's what's critical. And here, if you got a 2-inch chisel and an inch and a half chisel and a slick, you got all these tools to keep sharp, and you got to keep them razor sharp. So I just do everything with the inch and a half. And I use the inch and a half as a slick. And I've actually worked with guys that carry around an axe. I worked with this one guy, he carried a briefcase. I come here with a truck and all these things. This guy came on a bus with a briefcase, and all he had in it was a hand axe. And he had a scriber, had a little simple scriber, and that was it. And he used that axe chop, to slick, to chisel. He used it for everything.
Was it a broad axe?
No, it was just a small hand
like
axe.
Like a hatchet?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, more like a carpenter's hatchet.
And did he have an acute angle mount on that,
do
you remember?
Like 25 to 35 degrees is kind of most, covers most materials. I mean, you think pine, you would need something...
But not on an axe, just ground on both sides.
Depending on what it is, like, yeah, if it was... still have a hand-hewing axe that they could true place. Yeah.
And these timber framers, you try to stick with traditional tools, or you move it towards more power tools to do this work?
There's a whole litany. You can go broke buying all the power tools they got. Like I was saying, Jack loves to listen to the squirrels in the pines while he works, and he doesn't wear headphones, so he does everything traditional.
That big 12-inch skill saw that we saw at Makita?
Oh, they have like a 16, I think.
That's what it is, a 16, but Mafel is a German company. Uh-huh. They make 25-inch.
And then there's a Pratsy, the little chainsaw, mm-hmm.
chainsaw
mm-hmm.
that
goes on your
circular
saw.
Yeah, it
goes on
worm gear. Yeah, and you got to be able to cut through on those. Yeah. Like, you can't set depths on those.
Those are a little finicky from what I've heard, too.
Yeah. The German tools are spot on. They are, and they charge for it, too.
Oh, yeah.
But they are spot on. Like, the Makita 16-inch skill saw has a table that's this wide. It's like worthless. And I find I'm holding the guard and the handle, and I'm actually lifting one side off or another. Because when I'm cutting through a timber, a square timber, I'm not only watching that line that I'm cutting, I'm watching the side as that blade's going in. And I'm always trying to cut where my line is on the outside part of the side of the blade so I can see it going through. And brought me to another point. I just wanted to show you guys the difference between, you know, tight jointery. And come on up here if y'all would. Let me just get these out of the way. So this is an example of extreme out of square, okay? And I saw this just for this reason. So when I started to lay these out, I'll look for my squarest side. Okay? Here's a post. Let's imagine this is 8 foot long. Then I will... I'll set my tape out here. What's this good for right there? Keep it from rolling inside there. That's all it's good. So I'll mark like 6 inches up. I always got a tenon on the end.
Cut it in.
At least. Cut it. I cut a foot. Because I can see a foot mistake from across the shop. I can't see that inch mistake. So I cut a foot, and I measure everything in feet and inches. If I do inches, if I like measuring all in inches, I'll cut 10 inches.
Anybody else want wheels?
Okay. That way it's so much easier to see that 1 inch. Oh, do I add it? Do I subtract it? Well, 10 inches, it's obvious what you do. So I'll actually find this square, and I will mark in here chalk.
So
those are my two reference faces. If you're a big fan of magic marker, I'll do them like that. Some people like to call one face primary and one face secondary. Whatever you like to do. So that's not a huge issue. So let's say we're. I'm going to come up here, 1, 2, 3. I'm going to cut a mortise. I'm going to cut a 6-inch for a 6x6 mortise. And I want an 18-inch brace. Okay? So I've marked my bottom line. And all the time I'm coming off a reference face, and it's critical here. You see, if I'm coming off a non-reference face, and sometimes you do, watch what's going to happen. I'm just going to make this line. If I like to keep my square down, kick it down here, that throws it out of square up here. So try and keep my framing square up to the top. And then I'll mark, let's say I wanted a 18-inch brace. I'm going to mark that leg, holding 10, go to 28. All right. Let's say that's it. I'm going to use that same line. And then my brace up was probably going to be about another 6 inches. And here's where I love taking these guys. You know, just to do that little micro jointery, I call it, like doing your brace jointery. You don't have to handle 30 feet of tape here. But what I wanted to show you was, I could lay out with just this framing square, with being such a small piece, I could, as long as I'm consistent, make my mark, and make my mark. Come down here to my brace and do the same thing. And that's just, that's all it is. And what I really wanted to show you was the difference between that and, let's say, a regular pencil. Because I can take this and I can actually sharpen that down to a knife edge. And it'll almost cut, I don't know if you can see that.
And so I rough
it out with the knife, and then I use sandpaper to get that final edge.
Actually, that's an old drafting tool.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But you see,
I don't have mine at home.
I do. Yeah, I keep mine above my workbench because I use it on my pencil.
Hey, I got a file for sharpening.
High tech.
No, sandpaper. That's, I mean, it's an ancient file.
You just go in one direction.
So, well, what I wanted to show you was the difference between these two lines. What I'll do is I'll lay out all my, as many sawhorses, I'll load my sawhorses up. Got like 10 pair of sawhorses. I'll load 2 timbers on each set. Lay out everything I can. Then I'll go do something else. Eat lunch, maybe go do some other project. Then I come back And as I've laid this out like I did right there, I will have it drawn in there what's what. And I'll like say, that's going to be 4 inches deep. This is going to be a half inch housing. And you see, I've given myself what lines I'm going to. Then I'll come back. And I like to use a cork back ruler. Then I'll come back, and it's got to be steel. And when I do my check, I check everything that I did on that piece. If everything checked out, then I go through and I take my knife, and I knife everything right on the money.
So you're always measuring cuts to your cuts?
Measuring.
I said you're always matching your cuts.
Absolutely. If you look on the one of these cheeks on this thing, when I'm cutting with the skill saw, I know I've left one on here. It'll leave a little edge, and here you can see it right here. And it'll, instead of that saw, you know, the blade's coming up and it's kicking that chip in your face. But when you've cut that, it doesn't. There's no longer a chip, so you can. So it'll fly off, and you can see just how close. Because I love to get the saw, let it do as much work as I can, get it as close to that line as I can. But I still always come back, and you can see with that ledge, I can find that ledge with my. You see how it sits right in that little edge there? And then I pair right to the line with the chisel, always. But having that knife in it is a good way to know, okay, I've laid it out and I know it's checked and it's right, I can cut it. If I don't have it knifed, it hadn't been checked, And we all know about checking.
So you're always double checking, right?
Always. Every time I can put it in there. Make double, triple.
Yeah. The other way around. Those are ones you cut twice.
Well, you know, when you're dealing with such a big piece of wood, you can't do it. I mean, some of these pieces are, you know, $500 for one stick, and you can't afford to.